Good morning.
Good morning.
I have been reminded that it is the 4th of July and we have softball tournaments and lots of plans, so get things moving and don't preach too long. So I thank you all for coming and taking a part out of your holiday weekend to be with us. Let us call ourselves to the worship of God. Please rise. Why do we come to worship God?
We come to seek the blessing of our Lord.
What is this blessing that we seek?
We seek an encounter with our God,
who washes us in mercy, calls us to service, and fills us with love.
Let us worship God together. We will sing together, "America the Beautiful" or "A Beautiful for Spacious Skies" on 338,
and
if
I
you need
that
it.
Thank you.
stubborn and unbelieving, open our hearts to receive your word and set us free to follow in the power of Christ's love. Amen. Our scripture reading today comes from Paul's second letter to the church in Corinth. Listen for God's word to us. I know a person in Christ who, 14 years ago, was caught up into the third heaven. Whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows. And I know that such a person, whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows, was caught up into paradise and heard things that are not to be told, that no mortal is permitted to repeat. On behalf of such a one, I will boast. But on my own behalf, I will not boast, except in my weakness. But if I wish to boast, I will not be a fool, for I will be speaking the truth. But I refrain from it, so that no one may think better of me than what is seen in me or heard from me, even considering the exceptional character of the revelations. Therefore, to keep me from being too elated, a thorn was given me in the flesh, a messenger from Satan to torment me and to keep me from being too elated. 3 times I appealed to the Lord about this, that it would leave me. But God said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for power is made perfect in weakness. So I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may dwell in me. Therefore, I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities for the sake of Christ. For whenever I am weak, then I am strong. The grass withers and the flowers fade, but the word of our Lord endures forever. One of the first things I hear from almost anyone who has had to rely on someone else to help them do anything, whether it's drive somewhere, or get up and down stairs, or help with housework, or any sort of tasks that are hard to do. One of the things that I hear always, I'm so sorry, it's hard to be like this. It is hard. Because we have been told so long that we should be self-sufficient. We should be able to do it all on our own. I hear it a lot from tiny, tiny churches who think, well, we just can't do enough. Well, when I was in Galena, I was on committee on ministry, just as I am now. I don't think I'm ever going to get off committee on ministry. But one of the things that I do is I get to go and visit churches. And I went to visit this little church, this little bitty town. And on the rolls, they had 12 people. They had 3 people in session, which is a pretty good percentage if you think about 12 people. But as we met, they were a little nervous about meeting with me. And they said, we're a small town. And I said, I know. I drove through the whole town on my way here, and it didn't take me a minute. And they said, no, we're a really small town. And I know we've got 12. I mean, we're getting close to 15 on our rolls. We think we've got another couple who's ready to join. But we're a small town. And as they were talking, and we were sitting in this little kind of vestibule of the sanctuary, because that was the only space they had. There was a closet there. As we were stopping, somebody popped their head in the door. It was summer, so we had the door open. And somebody popped their head in and said, oh, are you open? And one of the elders got up and said, yes, come on in. And walked over to the pantry and helped them. It was a food pantry. It was really a pantry. It was not much bigger than your own home pantry, but they helped them find some things and take them. So have a great day, and walked out. And I thought, okay, in the half an hour I've been here, I've already seen the community come in. Well, as we continued on for a little bit more for our meeting, about that point, 3 little kids walked in, and they said, we saw the light on! And they said, well, we're having a meeting tonight, we don't have any music. children in our church, they said. No, those are neighborhood kids. They come by because we have a bluegrass band, a group from our church who just plays bluegrass music. It's not fancy or anything. I mean, it's just a couple of us with a guitar. We just kind of play and sing, and the kids like to come in, so the whole neighborhood comes in. And they kept apologizing for how small they were, and I said, you know, if you closed your doors, the whole city would feel it. The whole town would feel it. I don't think you're too small at all. I think you're doing wonderful work. But they were so sure that they needed to be in strength. They wanted to be strong before the presbytery came to visit them. But because they couldn't all do it on their own with just 12 to 15 people, they had opened their doors and the whole neighborhood came in. The whole village, it wasn't really a town, it was a village, came in. And I have often wondered why we kept these little tiny churches open. And I realized that's why. It was a place for the neighborhood to come in. And I also realized, because I was in the big church, I was in the town church. I mean, we had 80 people. We were big. We were big for the county. And I realized that, you know, we always kind of said, I don't know why they don't just leave and join us. Because it was too far away. As I grew up there, it might have been in the same county. But I grew up Stagecoach Trail for a long time before I got there. So, this was power in weakness. If they were doing what was right, it was still power. And you see, Paul's trying to explain this to the church in Corinth. Paul loves this church in Corinth. He really does. In this church in Corinth, oh my goodness. First, they get all caught up in this wrangling for who's got the most spiritual gifts. And so Paul has to come in and say, it's the same God who gives you the gifts. It's different gifts, but it's all the same spirit. Come on, guys. We've got to do this in love. So now Paul kind of thinks he's got them all together. And the next problem happens in the Corinthian church. You see, these super apostles are coming in and they're saying, if you follow us, it's all prosperity. There is all goodness and wonderful and richness. And this is the way you should go. And so they're all like, yeah, we're going to follow them. And so Paul comes back and Paul says, okay, I'm not going to boast of the revelations I have of God because God has told me that power is made perfect in weakness. You see, if I were claiming divine revelation and trying to make that sort of like I was above all of you, then it becomes that spiritual one-upmanship that we've been doing before. And it's long been a problem. So Paul refocuses them and says, power is made perfect in weakness. It's not strength, but weakness. And he points to Christ, who made humility a virtue. Because you see, when you aren't self-sufficient, it's easier to rely on God. It's easier to see how dependent we are on God. But it's hard for us to want to accept that weakness. When I was doing my internship, I remember I was a good student. You want to have things perfect. And so my first time preaching, it was going to be perfect, and I practiced it. Oh, I came up to the church and practiced it over and over again. And right before I preached, I was in the bathroom getting sick because my stomach was so messed up. And I didn't say anything else. And my mentor said, how are you doing? And I said, I'm great. I'm confident. I know that I've got a strong sermon. And she said, okay. So I went up there and preached. And afterwards she said, so you're going to tell me how you were really feeling?
Mommy, what was that?
And I said, what do you mean? And she said, Okay, so she goes, I know you were in getting sick ahead of time. She goes, would it have been okay to say, I feel some weakness here, I'm nervous? And she goes, we could have talked about it. I looked at Callie and I said, well, I've been told that you fake it until you make it. You show perfection until you don't, and then you just hope you don't mess up. And she says, so you're trying to be self-sufficient. Is that what I'm supposed to do? And she said, no. She goes, if I were nervous, I would talk to you. She said, I would tell you exactly what's going on. And she said, so what would have been the worst thing that could have happened? I said, well, I could have got there and forgot everything I was going to say. And she said, then it's a short sermon and nobody's upset. I said, oh, okay. She goes, so you see, if you really talk to someone else, you can realize that it's not. Weakness is okay. And then she modeled that for me. Because she was in a car accident a couple months later, and she was in a wheelchair because she had broken one arm and one leg, and so she, you know, couldn't get on crutches very easily when you're lopsided. So she was in a wheelchair. And when I went to take her out to lunch, a neighbor had to come over and help us get her into the car. Because she had to come downstairs, and so he'd come over and help her come down the stairs and come out into the car, and show me how to help her get out of the car and into the wheelchair. And I had to push the wheelchair where she was going, and I said, this has got to be so hard. And she said, no, it's probably an important thing. I've learned just how I have to depend on everyone else. And she said, no, did I want to be hurt? No. But she said, it did teach me. And I thought, what a wonderful model to have this, to realize that you don't have to be self-sufficient. Jesus was trying to teach that to his disciples. You see, in the gospel passage for this week, Jesus is sending the disciples up two by two, and they're ready to like pack a bag and go. They're going to get their backpacks together and be ready to go. And Jesus says, no, no, just your walking stick. That's all I want you to take. You're going to be dependent on the people you're serving. And the disciples look at him like, okay, Jesus, you're a little bit naive here. What if people reject us? Jesus says, well, then you just shake the dust from your sandals and move on to the next place. It's important, Jesus tells them, to be in community. Because to be the church, you need the community. And the community needs the church. Because the two work together. But if we're all self-sufficient, if we only think, well, we just have to take care of us, then we forget the great joy that comes with sharing. So Paul tells us, power is made perfect in weakness. We don't need to be self-sufficient because God is our refuge and our strength, a very present help in times of trouble. Therefore, we will not fear. Amen.
Amen.
Please rise and sing with me. Number 835, just a closer walk with you.
Oh.
We will faithfully bring our offerings to God.
You may be seated.
I'm going to see how this works. Okay. Come to a table, not defined by what you have, but by God's abundance. Come in celebration for hospitality, or in the pain of shaking dust from your feet. Come to the table in this familiar place, but partaking in unfamiliar ways. Come empty and be filled, or come with plenty to share and join in the feast. This table is not defined by wood or glass, but by the gift of Christ, which sanctifies everyday elements into his love made manifest. Here is the taste of the goodness of God. Here is hope and life and welcome for all. We remember that God's love is everlasting, and God's mercy is great. God calls prophets to call us back to faithfulness, even when it's uncomfortable. God loves us enough not to want us to fall out of relationship. We remember that Jesus healed those who would accept his gifts, but knew that we always have the choice to receive God's grace or reject it. We remember that weakness can be strength, and might does not always mean right. We remember that Jesus invites us, calls us, and loves us enough to share his very self with us at this table and at all tables that gather remotely in his name. We come to this table in both weakness and strength, knowing that God calls us wherever we are. Let us pray. God of the healing, we await your gift and your service. Send your spirit of life and love and of power and blessing upon your children in every house of worship, so that this bread may be broken and gathered in love, and this cup poured out to give hope to all. Risen Christ, live in us that we may live in you. Breathe in us that we may breathe in you. Amen. And we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
On the night of his arrest, Jesus took bread and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." The same way he took the cup after supper, and said, "This cup is the new covenant, sealed in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink this, do this in remembrance of me." Every time we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the saving death of our risen Lord until it comes again. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. And we are going to be taking communion in a little bit of a I will be dismissing you by rows. You'll come back. You'll grab a dead toothpick and a cup. Take off your mask, take it back there, and then there's a receptacle to put both things in beforehand, and then come and sit back down. So I will be dismissing you by rows.
Thank you.
Holy God, we give you thanks that you have made us one in the body and blood of Christ our Lord. Send us forth in the power of your Spirit to proclaim the peace of Christ and to share your reconciling love with sisters and brothers near and far. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. We will sing all of the verses of hymn number 340. This is my song.
Hallelujah.